Blackstone Audio presents The Exterminators, an assassin bug thriller by Bill Fitzhugh. This book is read by Tom Weiner. To all the fans of pest control, thanks for waiting so long. This one is dedicated to Paul Anik and David Thompson, both taken too soon. And for Kendall, without whom there would be no bug books. Chapter 1. La Paz, Bolivia, 1998. In his 30 years as an assassin, Klaus had traveled the world, seeing many strange and terrible things. But as far as he could remember, this was the first time he had stared into the black, bulging eyes of a dried llama fetus. He was in the back seat of a hired car in the old quarter of La Paz known as Mercado de las Brujas, the Witch's Market, where traffic snaked slowly through the crowded, narrow lanes. As the car crept along Calle Sagarnaga, the driver noticed Klaus studying the native women in their bowler hats and vivid dresses as they hawked the heads of boa constrictors, goat testicles, and toad talismans.
"They're witches," the driver said. "They sell these things for the rituals."
Klaus said nothing. The driver looked in the mirror, hoping to catch Klaus's eyes.
"The peasants still make offerings to Pachamama. They burn these things as offerings in exchange for luck, health, prosperity."
He put his arm on the seat back and turned to face Klaus, more serious than he had been.
"Few outsiders have seen these rituals."
Here he lowered his voice and continued.
"But if you are interested, I could arrange for you to see. For a price."
Klaus said nothing. This was obviously a con of some sort, a clip-joint operation. The driver, steering wealthy, thrill-seeking foreigners into the hands of associates who would take them into the mountains with the promise of perverse entertainment, then trade them a shallow grave for whatever was in their wallet. Klaus's silence gave the driver another idea. He said,
"Or perhaps you are the type of man who prefers a more sophisticated type of diversion."
Klaus fixed a grim stare into the mirror and said,
"Or perhaps I am the type of man who prefers that you shut up and drive."
And that was that. The driver took a left out of the market and zigzagged south and east until he was dodging stray dogs and children scavenging for the same food in the shadows of the snow-capped Imani. Chapter 2. It was dark by the time the car stopped outside a vast gated estate set into the mountainside. Klaus took his attaché case and told the driver to wait. While armed guards searched the car, others led Klaus into the compound, patting him down and inspecting the case before letting him continue. Klaus followed the footlights illuminating the stone path through the lush subtropical landscape. The green canopy throbbed with singing samba and red-skirted tree frogs, their long, trilling croaks competing with the stridulating organs of 10,000 insects. Klaus thought of his new friend and the room filled with assassin bugs in the basement of his house. Well, his former house. His former bugs. What a waste they had to be destroyed. But at the same time, what a brilliant idea. The first part of their great gamble. And now it was time for the second part. Klaus paused to examine an orchid, vivid purple with a yellow stripe like a tongue sticking out of a child's mouth after a lemon candy. Continuing up the path, Klaus noticed something out of the corner of his eye, flying at him, a gray blur, an irregular flight pattern. His first thought was bats. There was no time to react. The thing was on him, grabbing. Klaus looked down at his shirt. A giant Brazilian cockroach, Blaberus giganteus, nearly 4 inches of mottled translucence, the odd oval head covering, and the twitching antennae frisking him impolitely. Klaus choked back a girlish scream before it could escape his throat. He dropped his attaché case and did an embarrassing dance on the pathway while trying to brush the twitchy cockroach off his shirt. But the sharply spined tarsi held fast to the fabric. Finally, with great trepidation, Klaus grabbed the thing and tossed it back into the flora, wiping his hands feverishly on his pants. He shivered and took a moment to compose himself before continuing up the path. Only when he emerged from the jungled landscaping could Klaus see where he was going. He had to tilt his head back to take in the enormity of the place. Too big to call a house, wrong architecture to call a mansion or a palace, more like a fortress. Klaus guessed it was 40,000 square feet built into the side of a mountain. It was the estate of Miguel de Jesus Riviera, the man who put a $10 million contract on the head of an assassin known to him as the Exterminator. As a result,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.